in the lower primary grades, you know, it's all about keeping it fun and making sure that they want to do it. And that's the role of the teacher, is mm-hmm. is not just to teach the kids, but it's to motivate them, right, to keep it fun for them constantly throughout the class so that they're not dragging to school every day. And, you know, my themes, they turn over every 2 to 3 weeks. So just as the kids are starting to get a little, you know, tired of them, boom, it changes and the classroom turns into a completely new atmosphere for them. And this is the show where we celebrate the positive contributions of individuals in our community. It is my pleasure today to have with me kindergarten teacher Kurt Schwengel, who is the founder of rockandrollkindergarten.com. Thanks for joining me, Kurt.
My pleasure.
I love having you. Before we get into our little talk together, I wanted to show everybody what your kindergarten classroom looks like. So okay. Hopefully, will you allow me to do that?
Please.
All right, so this is a some video I took of Kurt's class back a couple of months ago. Enjoy looking at Kurt Schwengel's kindergarten classroom at Franklin School in Santa Monica. Okay, so tell us what's going on here.
So this is a mystery word right here. The kids get to see a mystery word, which are all NBA team names. And if it's not the mystery word, they'll come up there and cross it out. Let's let them cross it out.
Okay.
And the secret is that they guess words for 14 minutes, and then when I say it's about time to rotate, the next word is the mystery word. They never catch on to it. In 15 years, no kid has ever caught on to that. So that's what was amazing. I'll show you some of the other stuff I did on the smart board. Here is the gross motor basketball station, where all the kids are shooting baskets. And we're going to drop our twos because they have to keep their team score up there.
How many kids are there?
21. This is probably today, but 21 on the roster. And so every time they make a basket, they have to go to their little whiteboard and they take out the teams. You see all USC, Calisian.
Almost has to be zero right now.
They haven't won yet. Okay.
Good.
And then over here, Fernando, can you sit in the chair, please? Here we're going through it all. Number names.
Okay.
And they have to count the 30 by 2, or by 1s today, and then later in the unit, they'll count the 2s. So the first time through, they have to do it one color. The second time through, they have to do it two colors in an AB pattern. Third time, three colors, fourth time, four colors.
NBA's
real dunk in 3D. That's the 3D graphic. You ever want to make it 3D? It's 3D graphic. You should make it not more of it. And then you see here the whole great kids basketball business. It was a surprising number of
you know what I like?
Everything we do has to do with basketball. So people are going to be asking you, what was that all about? Tell us all about your classroom.
Well, first of all, clearly my thematic units are just an excuse for me to dress up. So that's the basketball unit. So what I've done when I started teaching 15 years ago was I wanted to, rather than do the standard kindergarten themes, teddy bears, pets, farm animals, stuff like that, I wanted to see what the kids were really interested in and create thematic units out of that. So I created thematic units out of Star Wars, baseball, basketball, bowling, pizza restaurant, pirates, construction, stuff that I didn't have to push on the kids. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people look at my classrooms and think that maybe it's a boy-oriented class, but remember, this is kindergarten. Girls love basketball as much as the boys, mm-hmm. and more instances than not, the girls are better than the boys at this age. So you see, we do in my classes, we just dive into the theme. For everything we do for the 3 weeks has to do with basketball. And then there's always a big field trip attached to each unit. Like for the end of the basketball unit, we go to the UCLA-USC women's basketball game. I don't know if you noticed, but my teacher's aide is a USC Trojan. Uh-huh. So we have a yin and yang thing going on in class. I went to UCLA and I brainwashed the kids to love UCLA. And he secretly takes them aside and brainwashes them to love USC. So
we didn't show it on that video clip, but the way you do the transitions is you have them do the UCLA fight song.
We do the 8th chapter, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and the kids love it. And you know, if the principal comes in, it's a math activity.
Well, and the kids love it. That's the first thing that strikes out about your classroom is you have kids that are excited, they're happy. Do you see that in other kindergarten classrooms you go to?
I do, but a lot of times when teachers ask me discipline problems, I would say the first thing you need to look at is the curriculum.
Mm-hmm.
If the curriculum's not engaging the kids, and by kids, I pretty much mean boys. Boys run the class. You control the boys, you control your kindergarten class. Now, that's not only, you know, in the upper grades, it's different. But in those lower grades, if you ask most teachers who are your top three discipline problems, more often than not, 2 out of 3, if not 3 out of 3, are going to be boys.
Mm-hmm.
And they just have all that energy, and they need to get it out. So another thing I was looking for in my curriculum was, what could I create that has the kids actually getting out some energy during class time? So you saw the basketball station where the kids are actually shooting baskets in class, learning to count by twos, you know, up on their little scoreboard every time they make a basket.
Mm-hmm.
But they're also getting that energy out. You know, like today, a rainy day like today, heaven help us all if these kids aren't getting their recess and they're bottling it all in. And another thing about it is that, you know, it allows each kid to be successful at a different station. Like, I don't like a whole language arts rotation where it's 4 language arts stations, because the kids, like me, when I was young, who struggled in language arts, get to go, well, let's see. I'm going to struggle there, and I'm going to struggle there, and I'm going to struggle there. Oh, great, and then I get to struggle there.
Yeah.
A rotation like that has math, art, a fine motor activity, and then something gross motor like baskets, shooting baskets.
Mm-hmm.
Every child has something to grab onto and go, you know, even if I'm going to struggle at the language arts station, it's just one station. And then I move on to math, and then I get to shoot baskets. And you get to see all the kids being successful within an hour instead of the same kids being successful within that hour and the same kids struggling. I like to really mix it up. So I do that for all my units, basketball, you know, baseball. We play baseball in class. We throw wiffle balls to each other. Bowling, I set up a 2-lane bowling alley in the classroom. And have a little ball return, and the kids keep score up on the smart board.
Mm-hmm.
So you see there's a lot of movement, and you can hear the music's always playing, keeping the energy level real high.
Well, I was going to ask, how do you cover all the state standards in your classroom? Do you find covering them all?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I wouldn't be able to do that if I wasn't covering all the state standards.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, if you look at the kindergarten state standards, you know, they're basic, you know, counting by ones and twos and addition, subtraction, language arts, phonics. But that's one of the things I love about kindergarten is you can meet the state standards, but package it any way you want. One of the other classes at my school is studying fairy tales. Mm-hmm. I'm studying Star Wars. So that's where we learn character development and plot and illustrations and stuff like that. But in kindergarten, you're just allowed to be so creative. You know, I know you're prone to breaking into song in your classroom. You know, just any time during the day, you know, over 15 years, I've just gathered all this. You saw the books I have for basketball. I didn't go out and, like, sometimes teachers will look at my themes and go, I don't have the budget to, you know, buy all these books in 1 year. That's 15 years of collecting basketball books.
I didn't say about that. How do you get materials for your classroom? Because I know a lot of teachers, that's what they're going to be interested in.
Dig, borrow, and steal.
Uh-huh.
You know, rather than when the book fair comes to our school, every teacher gets a wish list. You know, I just look for everything thematic. And it doesn't mean, you know, if we're studying basketball that week at the book fair, I'll look for basketball, anything, whether it's Pirates, Star Wars. But if you look around bargain basements at Barnes & Nobles and stuff like that, all of these books, they all pass through the bargain basement bins. You just got to be in the right place at the right time. And, you know, I'm always looking to buy stuff. If I'm going to spend $20 on a Pirate game for the Pirate unit, the first thing I'm looking at is this going to last 30 years? Mm-hmm. I want 30 years out of all these books and everything I buy, so I only buy the sturdiest stuff, stuff that's not too flimsy, that's going to break in a year or two. So I'm not operating on some huge budget. It's just after 15 years. And then I ask for the kids' hand-me-downs. Mm-hmm. You know, if they're playing Guess Who in class and they're getting old after a couple years, the kids who graduate in a couple years, I'll email their parents and just say, you know, those games that you bought for your kids in kindergarten or, you know, just hand them down to me, anything that has to do. And by then, all of my parents know all my themes, so they just start handing me stuff as hand-me-downs.
So well, that strikes me about your classroom also is you have a lot of parent involvement in your classroom. How do you encourage all that parent involvement?
Well, I'm lucky to be in Santa Monica, in a part of Santa Monica where I do have parental involvement, but as a teacher, you know, it cuts both ways. Mm-hmm. You know, as you can see, I teach in a fishbowl. You know, I mean, all eyes are on me. It's not just me and the kids all day. So I try to harness the parents, and what I try to do is make it fun for them. Make it as fun for the parents as the kids, because what you'll find in some classrooms is a lot of parents will start out gung-ho, and as the year goes on, your parent volunteers start to taper off. And it might be a function of what you're asking them to do. Mm-hmm. If you're asking the parents to come in and run the basketball station, you might get a lot more dads in the classroom than if you're having them sit down and do a Hope Mifflin worksheet and telling them, you know, you got to teach them to count by twos on this worksheet or something. The dads would much rather come in and shoot baskets with their kids or, you know, doing the golf unit, run the putting station or mm-hmm. something like that. So I really try to keep it fun for the parents as well as the kids to keep them coming back. And then it's great for the parents because, well, first of all, the kids get to see, you know, this is a safe place. Mm-hmm. My parents, you know, are comfortable with me being here. It's great for them. They get to see me interacting with the parents who are now just about my age as opposed to 15 years ago when I was all, that's Mr. Johnson. This is how we do what we are doing today. Mm-hmm. But as long as I'm keeping it fun for the parents as well as the kids, they keep coming back.
Well, and you're a parent now. You have an 8-year-old and a 10-year-old. Now that you're a parent, how has that changed your teaching?
Less homework. I've gotten to see the inside of what homework does to the American family. And, you know, nothing against my kids' teachers, obviously, but if I were an upper grade teacher, I would give as little homework as possible. Mm-hmm. You know, I just saw the Waiting for Superman or the Race to Nowhere movies. Mm-hmm. And, you know, what struck me in those movies was, you know, we do have child labor laws in this country. You can't, like, if you had a kid on your show, you could only have them for so many hours a day. Mm-hmm. So it strikes me odd that we can have the kids in the classroom for 7 hours a day and then pile on 4 or 5 hours of homework. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't, you know, TV shows can't do that. And that's exactly what it is. It's work.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, so what I try to do is when I do give the kids homework, I make it optional, but I also make it fun. You know, I mean, I tell the parents, look, if your children don't want to do it, they don't have to. It's my job to make them want to do it. Mm-hmm. And that could go, you know, not necessarily up through fourth and fifth and junior high, because then you have some kids who just didn't want to do anything who really need it. But in the lower primary grades, you know, it's all about keeping it fun and making sure that they want to do it. And that's the role of the teacher, is not just to teach the kids, but it's to motivate them. Right, to keep it fun for them constantly throughout the class so that they're not dragging to school every day. And, you know, my themes, they turn over every 2 to 3 weeks. So just as the kids are starting to get a little, you know, tired of them, boom, it changes and the classroom turns into a completely new atmosphere for them.
What's your process for making your classroom engaging and fun? Because that's what, you know, there's a lot of boring standards out there for teachers to teach. And this is the struggle that any beginning teacher is going to have. What do you do when you're looking at your standards? How do you figure out how to make that engaging for your kids?
Well, to me, it's all about masking the learning. Kids don't know they're learning. You know, I mean, if, like, take the basketball clip you just saw, counting by twos. If you ask the kids at that station, what are you doing? They're not going to say, we're learning to skip count, or we're learning AB patterning, or counting by twos. They're going to say, we're playing basketball. Now, the offshoot of that is that they're learning to count by twos. And same with the bowling unit. When they're bowling, you know, they're learning their math facts to 10. You know, they knock down 7. At the beginning of the unit, they knock down 7 pins, and they count the 7 like that. And then they have to write how many up or how many down. And at the beginning of the unit, they knock down, they count how many are up, and they count how many are down. But by the end of the unit, when they knock down 7, they just write up their 7 and 3 because they're learning their math facts. But again, at that station, the kids, if you walk up to them and say, what are you doing? They're not going to say, oh, you know, I'm learning my math facts or I'm doing addition. They're just going to say, I'm bowling. So you see how I like to try to mask the learning so that the kids almost never know what's going on. Like the state standards, they don't even know.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm actually, you know, my goal is also to hide it from the parents, too. You know, I mean, I'm not going to sit the parents down and say, okay, this is where we teach them ABC patterns or something like that. I'm just going to say, here's a yummy math worksheet. Make them make a pattern out of Fruit Loops or whatever they're doing that day. And it's all about masking the learning so that they have no idea what's going on.
I love that term, masking the learning. I'm going to liberate that. I think that's wonderful. Now, you have a website called rockandrollkindergarten.com, and we're going to put that on the screen for you, rockandrollkindergarten.com. What's on that? What can teachers find on that website, and parents as well, on that website?
It's all my themes. From the beginning of the year, it's all thematic, and it's not just for schools, but, you know, if you homeschool your child and you're looking for ways to mix it up rather than just the worksheets that you're getting from your homeschool websites or anything like that. But it's all my themes, from dinosaurs to mysteries.
Mm-hmm.
We have a huge mystery unit where our 6-foot swordfish, I don't know if you saw it on the wall, our mascot Rocky gets stolen every Thanksgiving.
Uh-huh.
And it's like CSI Santa Monica. The kids come back to the classroom and there's a whole crime scene set up with, you know, handprints and fingerprints and footprints everywhere and police tape around the scene.
Uh-huh.
And the kids, you know, read Scooby-Doo books and decode mysteries and stuff, learn the alphanumeric code. And it's a mystery-solving unit. So if you go to the website, you get to see examples of all the different themes that I do and how to create them inside your own classroom or your home if you're homeschooling. A lot of homeschool. I'm always shocked that, you know, a lot of the responses I get are from homeschooling parents,
mm-hmm.
you know, who are really looking to mix things that my child's not grasping this concept. Is there another way to teach fine motor skills and teach the cutting exercises? And I, you know, point them towards the dinosaur cutting exercises where instead of just cutting out shapes, they're cutting out dinosaurs and stuff like that. It's harder.
Well, the reason they're homeschooling is they don't have teachers like you in their classroom. And I don't blame teachers at all. I mean, that's what Waiting for Superman, one of the problems I had with the movies, they blame teachers for everything. And I'm like, you know, a lot of them have handcuffs.
Absolutely.
They teach in a very prescribed way.
Especially in districts where, you know, and this is what Waiting for Superman didn't address, is like you said, teachers are handcuffed.
Mm-hmm.
By box curriculums.
Yeah.
If you go to a lot of districts, you know, they run Open Court or the Hope Mifflin programs, these teachers are not allowed to be creative. And, you know, here we've taken this incredibly creative field and said, you're now teaching from a script,
mm-hmm.
which was good 10 years ago when we implemented class size reduction. When Pete Wilson did the class size reduction and brought class size down to 20, the downside to that was thousands of emergency credential teachers flooding the classrooms because they didn't have nearly enough teachers to cover all those classrooms.
Yeah.
And in come the box curriculums. And those are the teachers that needed to read from a script.
Yeah.
But nowadays, you know, I mean, we're slowly creeping up on being told to brace for 27 kids next year. I think every district is increasing class size, and I'm not sure it'll ever go down again to 20. But these box curriculums came on the scene, and teachers started teaching from scripts. And I don't know if they're still doing it or not, but you certainly couldn't pay me enough to teach them a script.
Well, there's lots of magic pills out there in education. One of the things that people always address now is technology is the answer. Now, I hear that a lot, and I see a lot of people that don't understand how to use technology. You do actually know how to incorporate technology into your classroom. I was hoping you could share with us some of your tips on making a technologically sound 21st century classroom.
Well, I travel the country. This is one of my other gigs, is I travel the country teaching teachers about technology in the classroom as well as creative teaching. And the first thing I have to teach them is that in the lower primary grades, technology is just a tool.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a subject. You're not teaching them the operating system. You're not teaching them programming. It's just another tool. And I'm realistic enough to know that at my most engaging, it doesn't matter if I'm reading the best Star Wars book in the world or anything like that. At my most engaging, when I'm reading to the kids on the rug, I have 70 to 80% of their attention.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not deluding myself into thinking I have 100% of their education. I was one of those kids that could sit on the rug, look right at you, and not listen to a word you say. I was like that. But here's the thing about technology. When I'm in front of the smart board, or I have one of the iPads, I'm teaching a lesson from one of my iPads in class, it's 100%.
Mm.
kids are so locked into the technology nowadays. Now, in 10 years, these smart boards and iPads are going to be so passe, they're going to bore the kids to death because they're going to be doing 3D holograms on their desk or something. It was so exciting to be able to hunt in class. But the technology as a tool, it's just like, you know, you're not doing a whole lot that you can't do on your whiteboards. But the thing is, the kids are so captivated by it. You know, when I'm in front of the smart board, there are no discipline problems. Nobody's wiggling around on the rug. When I'm doing flashcards nowadays, rather than just getting and making 3x5 flashcards, they're on the iPad, and I'm just flipping through them on the iPad, and everybody's locked in.
Wow.
And, you know, and these iPads are great. They're kind of the next wave. And I have my kids playing a lot of games in the classroom on the iPad. And one of the reasons for that is, you know, you can have the kids playing checkers, old school checkers. One of the problems with that, what are some of the problems with checkers in kindergarten?
With kindergartners, they have to find their eyes, throwing the checkers at them, or
they're eating them, they're throwing them. But even more than that, you know what they're doing? They're cheating.
Yeah.
You know, because they play with their dad at night, uh-huh. and they get to king themselves whenever they want.
Uh-huh.
The first move out of the gate is king me. The great thing about the iPad, it doesn't allow them to do that. They can only move in the correct direction.
But is that teaching them the real-life skill?
It's teaching them the problem-solving and the socialization, but as far as, you know, kindergartners could actually play chess on an iPad because they can only move them in the correct direction.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the things I like about technology is it reins them in, but it brings in their attention so that they're just so locked in on everything you do. You know, you don't have to worry about the wiggly kids on the rug and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. They're just so, especially the smart boards. The smart boards are really captivating to them.
I would be remiss if I didn't talk to you about this, Kurt, because I've watched thousands of teachers, and, you know, you're an amazing teacher. And 96% of kindergarten, first and second grade teachers are female. What motivated you to teach kindergarten?
You know what? It was the creativity. When I student taught, I did, you know, had to do the gamut of all the different grades. But it was the creativity, the fact that, like I said, you could package it however you want. By fourth and fifth grade, you're kind of locked into California missions mm-hmm. and multiplication tables, and there's only so many ways you can teach that. But I noticed in the lower grades that, man, I could get away with a lot down here. Mm-hmm. I could really do a Star Wars unit. I could really do a mystery unit. And another thing that really interested me about kindergarten was being their first teacher.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I know most of my kids have gone to preschool, and they've had Miss Betsy and Miss Lauren as teachers and stuff like that, but they know that kindergarten, you're on the big campus now, there's a sense that real school is starting, and I just love being their first experience. You know, to swing that door open and be their first teacher and set them up for how fun school can be.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as opposed to being a fun third grade teacher, surprising them, you know, with how fun school can be. I like to be their first teacher, teach them how fun school can be, get them running to school every year so that that's the expectation. You know, so that, you know, they're not running to school to learn spelling or anything like that. They're coming to school, well, we're studying Star Wars today, or, you know, we're going on a pirate treasure hunt. And just, again, to mask the learning and keep them reined in to where I'm teaching to the state standards, but I get to package it however mm-hmm. I want. Yeah.
Well, and you might met through public speaking. You're, mm-hmm. you're absolutely one of the best speakers I've ever seen. You gave a great keynote on kindergarten and the history of kindergarten. I found myself captivated, you know, because the founder of kindergarten is actually a man.
Yeah.
And I was hoping you'd tell us a little bit about that because it's actually one of the best speeches. You need to post that speech. It's fantastic.
It's an amazing story, actually. You know, most people don't realize that kindergarten was actually invented.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't just happen. I mean, I'm always surprised at how few kids over the years have asked me, why is first grade called first grade when kindergarten is really the first grade?
Mm-hmm.
Well, back then in the 1800s in Europe, 7 and 8, you didn't start school until you were 7. Everybody else was housed in these big infant asylums, they called them in German. Exactly. And you know, it never occurred to anybody that a child under 7 could actually learn anything. Until this guy, Frederick Froebel, came along, opened up the first kindergarten, and his motto was, let us learn through play. Which is also my motto, you mm-hmm. know, in kindergarten. You see all the play that's going on in the classroom, you know. And that's one of the tragic things is, you know, that's left us from the state standards is play, socialization, fun. You know, these are all the words you don't see, you know. But the original idea for kindergarten was let the kids play, let them socialize, let them get the basic tools for learning, But adamantly, you know, he was, Thurber was against any introduction of letters or reading. And, you know, so what's happened over the last 30 years since you and I went to kindergarten is we're teaching the first grade that you and I went to. We've gotten away from Thurber's vision of kindergarten being play and socialization, and we've just turned kindergarten into first grade. And it's, you know, if these kids aren't reading by the end of kindergarten, not that they're labeled special ed, but they're red flagged, you know? I mean, and you have to ask yourself, what's the cost?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what's the cost of all these academics being pushed on these kindergartners? And, you know, in California, as you know, our cutoff date is still December 5th. I think that they're grandfathering it and slowly moving it up to September. But I'm still teaching a lot of four-year-olds.
Yeah.
I'm trying to teach four-year-olds to read.
Yeah.
It's not the easiest game.
What made you want to become, we're starting to run down on time. What made you want to become a teacher, Kurt?
I went to UCLA, like I said before, and I played baseball at UCLA. And as much as I loved being on the baseball team, what my brother and I have a twin brother, what we found ourselves looking forward to the most was working the summer camps when we could work with the kids. And we just, you know, personally, I think my brother and I, we were just blessed with voices that kids listen to. You know, you walk into some classrooms and you can just tell.
Mm-hmm.
That just, some teachers just have that voice where you could put them in front of any classroom, you say, teach any subject you want, and the kids just pop up when their voice comes up. And my brother and I, we were just blessed with those voices. So we got into working with UCLA baseball camps, found we had an affinity for it, and then when it came time, you know, to graduate and go on to graduate school, there was no doubt. There was no doubt. It was all about teaching.
What advice do you give our viewers who want to become teachers?
My advice is, what I think is lacking from teacher training programs is you have to understand it's a performance. Teaching is a performance art. You know, you may love science, okay, and you may love math. If you're really, really into those topics, you may want to pursue those fields, but teaching is performing. You're on a stage every day. And if you're not comfortable with public speaking and performing, like if you've never been on a stage before, you might not be the best teacher or suited for teaching because that's what you are. You have an audience that you need to engage every single day for an hour at a time if you're a high school or 6 hours at a time if you're primary.
Mm-hmm.
And you've got to keep it fresh and you've got to keep it fun. But it's not about the content, it's about the performance. And if that's what you're interested in, you know, I would like to see us fielding more actors into the teaching profession rather than, you know, your future mathematicians and stuff. I think all these actors need to get into the classroom, and same with athletes who love to perform,
mm-hmm.
you know, and get that rush back from the applauding crowd. These kids, they're your audience. You know?
Well, you certainly keep it fresh, you keep it fun, and you mask the learning. The website, everybody, is called rockandrollkindergarten.com. It has been my pleasure to have with us this week Kurt Schwengel, who is a kindergarten teacher at Franklin Elementary School in Santa Monica. He is making a difference every single day. There are heroes like this around us all the time. Folks, you can make a difference, too. Remember that. Have a blessed day. Talk to you later.